Okay, so welcome you all for this yet another Cool Synergy session. Today we have a very interesting session of problem solving in primary years for mathematics, and we would be focusing on the fractions concept. And we have a very I would say experienced a facilitator here, Rudri Joshi, who is working in Gateway Schools and has been facilitating learning of mathematics for many years. So just let me tell you a little bit about the School Synergy workshop series. We have been having this session every Saturday, 3 to 4 p.m. for past 1.5 years. And even during the pandemic times, we have continued to have this session every Saturday. Almost every Saturday, we have taken a few breaks in between because we need to cater to other tasks of our own. So in this session, what is our focus? Our focus is to select ideas which can form a bridge between the ideas, theoretical ideas which are discussed in university level and the practical ideas which are implemented in the classroom level. Because often it is said that the ideas that are discussed in workshops really do not help in the classroom because you do not know how to practically work on it. But in these sessions, we have definitely tried to take up those ideas, show an example of how it can be implemented in the classroom, discuss teachers' experiences, and essentially build a community of teachers, teacher educators, and even student teachers and students of education also. So over the past 1.5 years, we have had very diverse audience, teacher educators from colleges. We have had teachers, in-service teachers joining in. We have had student teachers joining these sessions. And we have had very, very fruitful sessions and discussions. The discussions have been mostly very interactive. And we have also had a Telegram group in which we continue our discussions after the session, and we discuss ideas that are shared here. We also share about other kinds of activities and sessions that are taking elsewhere, readings that are related to the topic of our interest. And we have tried to essentially build a community which supports each of us in developing a deeper understanding of teaching and learning, and especially with the Indian context. And you'll be happy to know that people have been joining all across India for these sessions. Lately, we have also started a follow-up session. So we will have a sharing. Today, the facilitator will be sharing their ideas. And in the follow-up Saturday, that is the next Saturday, we have discussion on experience sharing or building on the ideas further. So wherein teachers bring up their design ideas, bring up their, they can share their lesson plans, they can share the experience that they have had with the same or similar ideas that are shared in the first session. So without much ado, I ask Shalini Soni, our student in the Center for Excellence in Teacher Education, to please introduce our speaker of today, Rudri Joshi. Shalini?
Hello. Yeah, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am. Hello, everyone. Thank you again for coming and making this place such a great learning for each other. So today we have Ms. Rudri Joshi. She has been with Gateway School of Bombay for the past 6 years. She has earned her bachelor's in special education, learning disabilities, and master's in psychology from SNDT Women's University, India. Currently, she is the maths curriculum design and implementation at Gateway School. Rudri also works on outreach projects to support mainstream schools in building inclusive practices. Her interest lies in exploring technology to optimize learning and facilitate inclusion for all students in classroom. Thank you so much, Ms. Rudri, for coming and sharing your experiences. So without wasting much more time, I request Rudri to please come and begin the session of today. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Ruchi and Shalini, for that warm welcome. Pretty excited to start. I'm just going to start sharing my screen, guys, and let's get started. So, guys, I am Rudri, and welcome to the session on strategies for problem solving in mathematics for primary years. In today's session, we will be looking at e-learning strategies in order to help your children learn problem solving in mathematics. The strategy we will be exploring today is one of my most favorite strategies in maths, which is mathematical models. We will be exploring both low-tech and high-tech strategies for the same. Just like how we conduct any gateway session, I want to share with you a couple of expectations that I have from you, which is number one, if it's your turn to talk, please unmute and share your ideas. Whereas if it's your turn to listen, then please stay on mute and help us facilitate listening. The second expectation I have from you is try and keep your video on so that I'm able to see you, I'm able to connect with you. And especially during, you know, virtual learning times, it's honestly very hard to, like, you know, connect with people. So if you could turn on your camera, that will allow me to, you know, make connection with you and learn with you. And I hope you will turn on your video. I can see Shalini's video is on. I can also see Sophia has turned on her video. Shubhangi has. I really appreciate you guys turning on your video. I totally also get there can be like bandwidth issues, but please try and keep your video on if you can. Thank you, Ruchi, for turning on your video. The third expectation I have from you is, under all circumstances, guys, you must participate by either raising a hand. So you'll just raise your hand. And Shalini, can you help me, you know, identify if somebody's raising a hand? Or you could, guys, also raise a virtual hand. So if you go to reactions, you'll see an option of raise hand. So you can raise hand to participate. Additionally, please feel free to put your questions in chat so we can clarify them as and when they come. The fifth expectation I have from you is, guys, you have to learn actively, which means you got to take notes and think about your context, because everything I'm sharing with you today are things that have worked in my context. And I completely acknowledge that your context will be very different from mine. They won't be same context. So please think deeply about what your context is like and how you can take ideas from here to your classroom. The last expectation I have from you is that if you're already part of the Telegram group, after we're done with this session, please, please, please post your pictures, post pictures of the work that you have done through the session. Yeah. If everyone agrees with this, can you turn on your video and show me a thumbs up? I had six expectations. I can see Shalini, Sophia, Samidha, Ruchi, Shubhangi, Vidya. How fantastic. I can see Chitra, Renu. Love it, guys. I can see Surjeet, Sabrani. Guys, love it. Love the participation. Nishu, Aryada. Fantastic, guys. I just love that you are trying to participate as much as you can from your side. All right. So with these expectations in mind, let's start. Just a heads up, through the session, you are going to be needing a couple of pieces of paper, pencil. So I'm willing to pause the session for 15 seconds so that you can get up, bring some paper, bring some pencil, and then we should be good to start. I can see Ruchi showing me her notepad. Guys, this notepad is not for you to take notes. You can also do that, but we'll be solving questions through the session. So please bring paper, pencil.
Yeah.
Right?
Essentially something to write, because it helps us to think more clearly.
Absolutely. Yeah. And there are activities designed that will force you to do things on paper today. So I hope everyone has got their material and we could start. Okay. Something else that we do at Gateway very often is use an attention grabber. And that's what I'm going to teach you today. So every time, guys, every time through the session I say class, I want you to unmute and say yes. Okay, so let's try this right now. Class.
Yes.
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 Class.
Yes. Yes.
Class, class, class.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes, yes, yes.
Class, class,
yes, class,
yes.
Class, class.
Fantastic, Vidya. Yes, every time I say yes, 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 you got to turn it and say class, class, class. So, okay. Guys, this is going to be my cue to tell you that, hey, you got to stop whatever you are doing and bring your attention back to the screen and start listening to what I'm saying. All right? Make sense? This is a cue that we've decided. Every time I say this, I'm trying to get your attention back to me. All right? Okay, fantastic. So let's begin class. The very first thing we are going to do is I'm going to share with you today's goal with regards to the, you know, series of lessons that we are planning to do right now. So by the end of next 5 lessons, the goal is that you can divide quantities involving fractions. Yeah, that's our goal. Like, I'm going to do 5 lessons with you right now. Of course, in a classroom setting, these wouldn't be instructional activities done in 5 days. They happen over the course of 2 months. But keeping the workshop time in mind, try to fit it in like 5 lessons. Okay. So this is the goal. Everyone in the group will be able to divide quantities involving fractions. Yeah. So the first thing we're going to do is a pre-assessment just to understand where is everyone, what we already know, etc., etc. Yeah. So for this pre-assessment, you're going to need a paper pencil. You are going to have 1 minute to solve the problem that I'm going to display on my screen. Please stay on mute when we are trying to solve this problem. Do not post your answer on chat or, you know, on Telegram group right now. Keep that answer to yourself. And once I display the question on my screen, I need you to start. All right. Let's begin, friends. You have 1 minute. You got to solve this problem. The problem is mentioned in pink color box. I have 4 kgs of sugar. I need to divide them into 2. Please read the fraction, guys. Bags. How many bags will I fill? Show how you know and explain your thinking. We have 30 more seconds to go. Class. Class.
Yes. Down, down. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Class.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
All right. Yes. I hope, I know 1 minute is not enough, but the idea is for you to just start some, you know, start parts of, trigger your brain to think about fraction, yes, problems right now. If you are able to solve this problem, fantastic. If you are not able to solve this problem, even fantastic, because something brilliant will happen to you in next 45 minutes and it will just change the way you look at fractions. All right. So the problem that you solved, please keep it with you. We are going to reflect with the responses you have at the end of the session. Okay. So whatever you experience right now, please hold that in your memory. Do not forget about that, because we need that piece of your thoughts, your feelings back when we reflect later. All right. So let's start with our very first lesson on fractions. This lesson goal is I can read a fraction correctly. So on my screen, I have a fraction. Guys, this fraction is called 1/3. This is called 1/4. This is 3/5. Can you unmute and read with me? This is 5/18.
18.
Fantastic. So now for the next one, it's your turn to read. Please unmute. Read the first fraction together in 3, 2, 1. Let's read.
2/3.
I absolutely love that Renu, Shravanti, Shubhangi, they all said 2/3. Fantastic reading, guys. What about this fraction?
4/9.
What about this?
300.
Absolutely. This is 300. I agree with you. What about this?
10/11.
Absolutely, guys. This is 10/11.
5/4.
Absolutely, guys. This is 5/4. What I also share with you is that, guys, these fractions are not 2/3. It is not 4/9. It is not 3/100. That is wrong reading. You're on. If you read fractions in that way, I want you to tell your brain to stop reading fractions as 3/100 or 3/100 and start reading them as 300s, 10/11s. Because this is the vocabulary related to fractions. When you read fractions accurately, your brain is able to visualize that concept better. When I am thinking of 3/100 or 3/100, I actually see a number that says 3/100. That is what I visualize. And I want to stop my brain from thinking in that direction. I instead want it to think like 300s. Yeah. You may be wondering, what does this visual look like? Let's learn about how to represent fractions using a model. So this time we've transitioned to lesson 2, guys. The fraction on my screen is 1/3. So 1/3 is a whole that has thirds. So it's partitioned into 3 equal parts. And each part is 1/3. And if I shade one, it's 1/3. All right, let me also show you one more problem, 1/4. All right, so I have a whole that's now partitioned into how many parts? Into 4 parts. So I have 4. And when I have 4, I shade one part. Yes. That's 1/4.
1/4.
Absolutely. I'm also thinking of a pizza right now. The reason I'm thinking of pizza is because it allows me to make sense of what the fraction is. It helps me learn from the context. So pizza is allowing me to bring that context. Let's look at one more fraction. Here we have 3/5. So essentially, a whole that is partitioned into fifths.
Divided into 5 parts.
Hi, I'm just going to request everyone to mute for a couple of minutes, and then I'll ask you to unmute as well. So this over here is 3/5. I'm thinking of 3/5 slices of pizza. I have a whole that's partitioned into fifths. Fifths are 5 equal parts, and then I shade 3 out of 5 equal parts. I shade 3/5, and that's how I model 3/5. So the strategy that you guys saw right now is draw it out strategy. Though of course it's on presentation, but in a classroom setup, students would draw something like this on a piece of paper. Let me also show you a slightly more technology advanced version of this. I want to model 1/3. I'm going to represent this on a website that I use in class all the time. It's called Math Learning Center. So in order to model 1/3, I first click on the shape because I want rectangle. It asks me how many parts. I say I want 3 equal parts. I want thirds. I say, okay. I bring the fraction and then finally I shade it. So I know this is 1/3. Now I'm trying to also model fourths because I have to model 1/4 this time. So I went here, chose fourths, and now I'm going to shade 1. Similarly, now I need 3/5. So I need a hole with 5 equal parts. And then I'm going to shade 3. And that's how I can see that these are 3/5. Yeah. So in class, I always have 2 strategies. And again, you can choose what makes sense for you in your context, draw it out or online. But this is one more strategy that we use in class. So you saw me model this by drawing it out and on Maths Learning Center. Now it's your turn to try it. The first strategy that you looked at is called draw it out, which is a low tech strategy. You do not require a lot of technology. You don't need Wi-Fi. You don't need a device. All you need is a paper pencil. It's a very low tech strategy. Whereas Math Learning Center is a very high tech strategy because you require internet. You require, like a laptop or a mobile phone. So in order for you to try it, I have 2 options available for you right now. You can choose to do this on a paper by drawing it out. Alternatively, I'm going to share a link with you in chat, which is like a worksheet that I have created on Maths Learning Center. You should be able to open this. Once you're done with your work, over here, you can click on this key and you can copy the link and paste and share your work in chat again with me. Yeah. So it's up to you. You want to use low-tech strategy of draw it out or high-tech strategy, Maths Learning Center. It's your choice. I am going to paste the link in chat. And for the ones who are planning to draw it out, I'm going to post questions over here for you to see. Also putting guys 2 minutes timer because it's your turn to solve. Solve it on paper or you could solve this on Maths Learning Center. I have shared the link with you in chat. The app name is called Math Learning Center. It's a free tool. It allows you to create a worksheet, share with your students, and your students can share their work back with you. It's compatible on Chrome, any laptop, on your mobile phone, etc. Please take some time to solve the problems. Feel free to draw. No, you do not need to download it. The link I shared will allow you to get to the actual worksheet that I've made. It's the same worksheet that you see on my screen. It's just one is online, the other one is offline. We have 1 more minute. Don't think of this as a race. Take your time, solve as many problems as you can. If you have explored Math Learning Center, do not close it. Please share your link with us back in chat. I would love to show others how you have used Math Learning Center.
Done, ma'am. I pasted the link.
All right. Fantastic. I'm going to check that up. All right. Fantastic.
How do you get to shade it? Like, is there an option for shading?
Yeah, there's a water bubble that you should be able to see.
Okay.
And if you click on that, it'll allow you to shade. All right, class.
Top bottom corner, man.
Yes, yes.
Class.
Yes, yes.
Yes, yes. Yes, yes.
Classity class. Are you able to hear me, guys?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
All right. So first, what I am going to do is, I am going to tell you that though on my screen you had 6 questions, but one way to differentiate for learners in your class, guys, is by giving as many options as they have, but not forcing everyone to finish 6. So I'm sure in this group also, I had some people who were able to solve all 6, but I also had some people who finished 3. So everyone had a choice. When students have choice, when we value their effort and the time they are spending on an activity versus speed, they are more likely to engage in, you know, task and not worry about getting it done. They're then focusing on learning. Just thought I'll throw one of the big ideas that I always keep in mind, especially in classroom context. All right. Gonna put the responses, the answers for these fractions on my screen. Please check your work if you use draw it out strategy on your sheet. So if you model 1/5 on your sheet, this is how 1/5 looks like. This is how 3/8 looks like. This is how 5/6 looks like. 2/3, 3/4 and half. Put a tick for yourself. If you feel like somewhere you made a mistake, then over there, put a heart, because I would like you to go back to that mistake and reflect about what do you need to do differently. Guys, brain science tells us that when you make a mistake, you form connections, and that is really, really powerful. So appreciate that you made a mistake, put a heart over there, and please go back to it after the session. So this is how one would model fractions. Since we've got I've got three responses. Oh, many responses, actually. I'm going to take some time and show everyone the work that I have received. So I have received this work I'm showing to you is of Shravanti's. And Shravanti has modeled many fractions. Just one suggestion for anyone who's using fractions, if you just click on this, it'll allow you to see the fraction quantity as well. I know in class, we usually have children who, you know, either have the model but forget to label the fraction. So this can just help them, you know, make sense of what the fraction is. I can see Shravanti's work, fantastic Shravanti. I know, I think Muskan also shared her work with us. Oh, I think Muskan shared a different link with us. Muskan, you will have to share after your work is done, okay? All right, very organized. You know, one below the other. Fantastic. I really loved how, you know, all models, all pothole models are of the same size over here, guys. Did you also notice that? Isn't that fantastic? So now imagine if I even have to compare fractions. I have to ask my kids, guys, what do you think? Is 3/8 greater in terms of the area or is 5/6 greater? Will my students be able to compare that? Will they be able to give me a response? This is them comparing unlike fractions. And usually this is a goal that they you know, do probably in grade 3, grade 4. And they are usually doing it in an abstract manner. And some kids just get it, but many kids, like, they miss out on the fraction. They'll just look at like 505, but I have to 5. But then some will just look at the denominator and think, "Arey, eighths hai, to ye bada hoga," and they will take that. Yeah. Yes, Ruchi, you wanna share?
Please, yeah, I wanna share. I just wanted to share about the solution that was shared. If you would have seen 2/3, there was it was not continuous. There was a gap in between. So there are different ways of even representing the same fraction. It is still 2/3, even if there is a gap in between. That is also absolutely something we need to highlight to the students.
Absolutely, guys. They should have all the freedom of choice. It, because they are learning, right? So it should be okay in whichever way they showcase their learning. And similarly, like, that's how you can even focus on, can you share with me 5 different ways of showing 3/5, right? That's where then the creativity comes in. All right, let's go ahead and let's look at our next part of the session. So I know many of you solved it on Math Learning Center. Many of you also use Draw It Out and made models on a paper. I want to ask you a question and I would love your responses in chat. Did you use a rectangle model or did you use a circle model? I know everyone who used Math Learning Center used rectangle.
I used both.
You used both?
Yes.
All right. Anyone else who wants to share whether they use circle or rectangle? All right. I can see responses flowing in chat, which is fantastic. I see many of you used rectangle. Some used
both. Yes, ma'am, rectangle. Ma'am, can you tell how to represent that fraction? Only the bars, rectangular bars are visible.
So if you'll open Maths Learning Center, just next to the rectangle, you're going to see a tiny circle and you can also model it using circles. But guys, hold your horses. What I want to ask you, a controversial question, which is, according to you, which is a better model? Is it the rectangle? Are you team rectangle or are you team circle? Share with me, what are your thoughts? Put them in chat. Love to know from you. I know today you may have used rectangle or circle, but which team are you in? Circle, rectangle. And also share why, okay? So I know many responses are like circle, both, rectangle, but guys, because I am team rectangle because I am team circle because I am team both because. So please share your responses.
That is a very interesting question and has really nice implication for teaching. Yeah,
absolutely, absolutely. I can see Reno says I'm team rectangle because it's easier to break into equal parts. Mustafa shares circle because it allows you to show the whole picture. Ashu shares circle because partitioning with more flexibility, also comparing. It's easy to divide. All right. Looks like we have a mix. Just to share perspective, guys, when we work in a classroom, not all our learners are high achievers, right? There are some learners who also struggle. When we model fractions using a circle, often when you are partitioning into even parts, so for example, 2 equal parts, 4ths, 6ths, 8ths, 10ths, etc., it's still easy to partition on a circle. But when parts are uneven, so for example, when you're modeling 5ths, 7ths, 9ths on a circle, it's extremely challenging. It's challenging for our regular kids. But imagine how challenging it can get for a learner who has learning difficulties. So I am just trying to be strategic about, and also which model is going to allow for transference. I know that if I use a rectangle, when my children learn about decimals, they can use a hundreds grid, which is part of a rectangle model. But on a circle, partitioning into 100 equal parts is going to be a challenge. So I want you to think of like efficiency, long-term transference, being able to set up kids for success. Like what will, take them through success? Ideally, a rectangle model will, but I'm not saying that you should never teach circle. I'm saying you should teach circle. But when it comes to transference, generalization, and long-term usage, encourage rectangle models. Because they are far more efficient through the use of rectangular pothole models. Learning is far more transferable to other concepts as well. So for example, ratios, when kids are learning about percentage, decimals, and more, honestly. Okay. This was a great interaction. I really appreciate you sharing your inputs in chat with me. Let's move on to our third lesson, which is, I can represent division as equal groups. So you can see on my screen, the question is 15 divided by 5. You know, guys, children who are in grade 1, 2, 3, when they first look at this, the only thing that comes to their brain is this. They're like, what? this does not make any sense to me. The text that you're seeing on my screen, guys, in Hebrew means I can't understand what you're seeing. It means that our children can't make sense of a division sentence like that. And hence, we want to give them context. So the context we can give them is there are 15 buttons and 5 on each shirt. So I can put them on 3 shirts. A concrete visual. How about we make our visual slightly more sophisticated? So I still have 15 buttons. I need to put 5 on each shirt. I'm going to use a dot representation this time. And I know I can put it on 3 shirts, right? Let me show you a more abstract version, but still a model. So 15 buttons, 5 on each shirt. I can put it on 3 shirts. The last model over here that you see is a part whole model. Though concrete allows you to make sense, visualize, but on the long run, it's not very transferable. The dot model is definitely a great model because it bridges the gap between abstract ideas and still allows you to visualize. But again, on long run, do you think kids are going to be able to draw like 100 and 1,000 dots? Impossible. And hence, we want to move towards far more sophisticated models. And the one that we are going to explore today is called pothole model, which is the third model that you can see over here. I know I have some questions and people are raising their hands. You want to go ahead with your question, Shravanti? Ask your questions. And also, guys, feel free to put your questions in chat. Huh? We can, like, as in when I look at it, I'll address it.
Ma'am, it's actually not a question. When you said that rectangle model is the best, I have attended a few workshops where they said Singapore has a better way of doing mathematics in primary where because they explain the subtraction also in the rectangle model. So that is how the rectangle model is so famous. So I just want to share that.
Absolutely. The rectangle model is that pothole model, right? And actually towards the end, I will take you through like a, you know, a journey of models and you will see how those rectangle models start at like kindergarten and can honestly go on to like 12th grade something. So definitely. All right, I'm going to start sharing my screen again so we can move ahead. We just looked at concrete, representational, and abstract version of the pothole model for division, right? Because the goal was for you to learn to represent division as equal groups. What I want you to remember from here is that every time somebody is talking about divide by 5, it really means how many groups of 5 do I need to make, or how many groups of 10? So 100 divided by 10 would be how many groups of 10 can I make? Something like 50 divided by 8 would be how many groups of 8 can I make? And so on. Yeah. It's your turn now. So again, I'm going to put some questions on my screen. And I think we will take about 1 minute. Try and solve as many questions as you can from here. There are 3 question options. One is 20 divided by 5. How many groups of 5 can I make? I have 24 samosas. Each plate can hold 6 samosas. How many plates can I fill? So how many groups of 6 can I make? And so on. I know some of you shared your responses in chat, but I highly encourage you using draw it out strategy and please model it on a piece of paper because I'm just going to stop sharing my screen in a bit and I would love to see the work that you are doing on paper. Class.
Yes.
Class.
Yes.
Class.
Yes.
All right. If you solve these problems on a piece of paper, I request you to hold it up because I am going to spotlight your work and have your peers check the fantastic work you have done by making your thinking visible on a piece of paper. So, looking for a brave soul, would raise a hand. Oh, I can see Shubhangi is trying to show her work. Shubhangi, you know what? You have a the blur background filter, which is making your work blurred. So is it possible for you to turn off the filter and then show us your work? I can also see, meanwhile, Renu is trying to show us her work. All right, let's spotlight Renu here. Renu has used a concrete strategy. I can also see, Renu, can you hold your paper slightly in the middle? I can also see that she's used a pothole model, the rectangular abstract model, as well as, like, you know, similar to a dot model to solve samosa problem. That's fantastic, Renu. Looking for one more person to share their work with us. Who can share? Shravanti, I think you have a virtual background.
There's Vidya S trying to share.
Yes, Vidya. Oh, fantastic. Hold on. Let me spotlight your work. All right, guys. Can you hold it straight? Vidya is all right. Yeah. Guys, are you able to see Vidya's work? She's, I think, used the dot model.
Yes, I can see that. Yeah.
The second one, she's used the pothole model, right? Yeah. Fantastic. Fantastic work, guys. You know, your children in class should feel like maths class is like an art class where we only do a lot of drawing and have fun. All right. Let me show you how I would have solved the problem. Over here, guys, you can see a pothole model, a more abstract model. 24 divided by 6. I can put 6 on each plate and I will need 4 plates. Similarly, 24 pots, 4 pots in a day. I'll need 6 days and or 6 artisans. Last one, 20 divided by 5. 5 on each, in each group. And that's how I have 4 groups. This is how I would represent division as equal groups. We've done a lot, guys. We've been looking at the screen for a very long time. And hence, we're all going to take a quick movement break. The movement break that we are going to take right now is related to multiplication, okay? The vocabulary of times. So what we are going to all do is, we are going to dab 10 times. I'm going to connect multiplication over here. I'm going to stop sharing my screen. If your camera is on, then please dab with us. If it's off, turn on your camera.
And I think I should call my son. He would love it, that I am dabbing.
Yeah, absolutely call him. All right, friends.
No, it's okay. Yeah.
This is how you can dab. So let's dab. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. You know, guys, why did we dab 10 times? We dab 10 times because I think I'm sure in the past 30, 35 minutes, we solved 10 problems in an incredible way. And hence, we have to celebrate by dabbing. Dabbing, multiplication, division, addition, you could do anything. This is just to bring some movement into classes because otherwise kids don't want to interact. Like, if there's some movement, it feels like, you know, they are also enjoying. And dabbing is very cool. your kids will also start associating you as a teacher who's very cool otherwise. Otherwise, it's like, you know, this teacher is very strict. I can't have fun with a teacher, but that's not true. So you can have some fun with your kids as well.
When I was teaching, I used to do the silent claps like this in between so that the kids could have some movement. And sometimes I would ask them to stand up and stand down, like, and do the silent claps. So any movement. And it really works very well in bringing the focus back, because if they have to sit without moving for a long time, they get very restless.
Yeah. Absolutely, absolutely.
And I would say that this is true for the students with special needs, as well as students who are who do not have these special needs.
Absolutely.
Both the students.
It's also true for you and I, because you really think you're going to be able to sustain a session where somebody is talking and you are sitting quietly. Like, how boring would that classroom be? For you also, right? Like, when you're attending a workshop or a session where you're just quietly listening, after a point you tune out. But when you're engaged in the learning process, your experience is far different, because so many areas in your brain are active. And we need that for our learners, because when more brain areas are active, more learning is happening. But when the brain is not active, learning is not happening. All right, let's go ahead since we've taken a break. And let's look at our next lesson, which is lesson number 4. Out of the 5 lessons, we're on lesson number 4. The goal of this lesson is, I can represent division by unit fractions as equal groups. All right. So over here, I am trying to solve 1/1/3. All right. I'm thinking 1 as one whole. So let me first model a whole. I'm also thinking of a context, okay? Because context is very powerful for my learners to make sense. So I'm thinking of 1 liter milk, and I need to put 1/3 in each glass, okay? That's my story for this. I need to solve 1/1/3, meaning 1/3 in each cup, and I'm trying to find how many cups of 1/3 can I fill. So I have a whole. I partition into thirds, and I can put 1/3 in one, 1/3 in the other, and 1/3 in the last. That's how I am going to need 3 cups or 3 glasses. Well, 1/3 in each. Similarly, I can also do 1/1/5 as 1/1, that's partition into fifths. And always remember, dividing by 1/5 or any number means how many groups of 1/5 can I make? So I have a whole, I partition that into fifths, and I know I can use 5 glasses where I put 1/5 in each. Yeah, all right. This is what I was doing. Now let's make that question slightly more challenging. This time I have 2 liters of milk and I need to put 1/3 in each cup, okay? So 1 liter milk, partition into thirds. My 2 liter milk, partition into thirds. Now let me start putting it in cups. I'll need how many cups? 1 cup, 2 cups, 3 cups, 4 cups, 5 cups, and 6 cups. Yeah? Remember, how many groups of 1/3 can I make? That is what we're trying to do when we're trying to divide by a unit fraction. Since we are using both low-tech and high-tech, I already showed you the low-tech version of this. Let me show you the high-tech. How can we do this on Maths Learning Center as well? So the question I have is 1/1/3. Let me first bring a whole. A whole partition into thirds. And now let me shade a whole. And now I need to put how much in each cup? 1/3 in each cup. So 1 cup, 2 cups, and 3 cups. So how many cups can I fill? I can fill 3 cups. Similarly, for 1/5, let me bring a whole with fifths. Move the wrong piece. Whole with fifths. And because it's a whole, it's important for me to shade all, because I'm talking about a whole, a full whole. 1 liter milk, 1/5 in each cup. Let's draw. 1 cup. So 1/5, this is 1/5 in 1 cup, 1/5 in the 2nd cup, 1/5 in the third cup, 1/5 in the fourth cup, and 1/5 in the last cup. And that's how I will need 5 cups. Similarly, for the last one, I will have 2 holes. And so with thirds, I'm going to first shade it and then duplicate it. So these are my 2 holes. And I need to find out how many cups. 1/3 in one cup, 1/3 in second cup, 1/3 in third, 1/3 in fourth, 1/3 in fifth, and 1/3 in sixth. So I'm going to need 6 cups. And I have solved this problem accordingly. Now, your turn to try. I will give you both options. It's your choice. You make a decision whether you want to work on Maths Learning Center or whether you want to work using draw it out strategy to solve the problem. Share the Maths Learning Center link in chat, and I'm resharing my screen. Here are the problems. I need you to practice representing division by unit fractions as equal groups. You have 3 problems here. I have also shared them in chat. For this, I'm going to give you 2 minutes. So try and solve as many problems as you can. I absolutely love how Vidya is trying to solve the problem on... Vidya, are you trying to solve this on paper? Are you on paper? Or are you on Math Learning Center? All right. I love that she's trying to showcase her thinking on the piece of paper. That's fantastic. I also see that Shubhangi and Shravanti have kept their camera on, are looking at the screen, and are super duper focused on the problem they're trying to solve. Amazing, you guys. We have 44 seconds more to go. Class?
Yes.
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 Class?
Yes.
Yes.
Class, class, class.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Class, 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 class.
All right. Fantastic. I absolutely appreciate how you are on class. I can see that we have someone who's trying to show their work on screen. I'm going to spotlight that. Absolutely, I can see you need 4 cups, and 6 cups. I can see Ada is also trying to show her work to us. Let's also look at Ada's work. Fantastic. You know what I really love about your work, guys? I really love that you have mentioned each fraction, and it's so visual. I absolutely appreciate it. Can I request one of you to explain and share with us the strategy you use? Can you use your words and tell me what did you do in this problem? Or anyone else who wants to, you know, make an attempt, if possible. All right. Okay, in that case, I have Shravanti's work on Maths Learning Center, which I would like to show to everyone. Shravanti, is it possible for you to unmute and share with us how did you solve these problems?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh. Go ahead, Shravanti. Please unmute and talk.
1 kg of flour is there, so I have to divide into 1/4 kg of cups. So I have, the whole has been divided into four parts. So one fourth cup. So 4 cups. So the kg flour has been divided into 4 cups, ma'am. Similarly, 2 kg flour. So I have taken two holes. So divided into 2 halves. 1 half, 1 half. So 4 cups I get. In 1 hole, 2 cups, and another hole, 2 cups. Similarly, moong dal. So 1/3 cup I have to take. So 2 holes. So I have taken 1 hole divided into 3 parts, the other hole into 3 parts. So total 6 bags.
Absolutely, guys. You know what I really loved? I noticed that Shravanti used her words to explain the strategy. She very clearly used words like holes. She said, you know, this hole had 2 halves and the 2 holes will then have 4 halves. She used such vocabulary to talk about, you know, how she solved the problem, which is absolutely fantastic. I really appreciate learners who use accurate vocabulary to share their mathematical thinking. It's amazing. I also noticed that Chitra has shared her work in chat with us. I'm just going to show you Chitra's work as well. All right. Chitra has solved the problem similarly, almost used the same strategy. I have one suggestion though for Chitra's work as well as for Shravanti's work, which is that when you solve a problem towards the end, it is also great if you can mention the unit that you used or your answer in that context. So for example, are you able to see my screen now? Is everyone able to see?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
I want to show you. I don't know if this is going ahead. Just give me a second, guys. All right. Are you able to see? I think this is frozen, it seems.
We can see your screen. Now it's gone.
Yeah, no, it wasn't animating. Just give me a second. Need the animation to come back. Are you able to see, guys, or is this a black screen? It is a black screen, right?
Yeah, yes. It's a blank screen. It's loading. It's showing loading. You just have to wait for a minute. It must be an internet issue, Rudri.
Yeah, I believe so. Yeah.
I just wanted to discuss one part while you get back to your presentation. See, in the present problem that Rudri had shared with us, notice what is the whole and what is the part, okay? So what will we call as a whole? Because she's talking about the part-whole model, right? So where is the whole? So in the first question, you can see the whole is 1 kg. 1 kg is the whole. In the second question, what would be the whole? Just think about it. Maybe we can discuss it later. Yeah. Rudri, are you able to get back to your presentation?
Yes, I am here.
Okay, then. Should we try once more?
I hope.
Let's see.
Getting into
just wait. Just hold on for a few seconds. Yes, it will happen. Yeah. See, this is an internet issue. It happens to me all the time, actually. Yeah, go ahead.
So, this is how a solution would look like. When I was talking to you about the unit, what I meant is once you're done solving the problem, I know you got your answer as 4, but it's important for you to write 4 cups because that is the unit we are talking about. Or 4 bags, or, you know, 4 minutes, or 4 plus something, because 4 is not the answer. 4 cups is the answer. Yeah. If you solved your problems similarly, then that means that you were able to get, you can put a check on this goal and we can go to the next part. Now, this time, notice that we have 4 holes, which means 4 liters milk, and I need to put 2/5 in each cup. So I have a hole. I need to put 2/5 in each cup. So I have 4 holes first. And because we are talking about 2/5, each hole will be partitioned into 5ths. And then I put 2/5 in each cup. So 2/5, 2/5, 2/5. How many groups of 2/5? So far I have 5. And then I have 5 more. And that's how I am going to need 10 cups. Let me show that to you on Maths Learning Center as well. 4 liters milk in 2/5 cups. So a hole, because we're talking about 5ths, partitioned into 5ths. Let me share it. We're talking about 4 holes. So let me also put 4 holes over here. So I have 1 hole, my 2nd hole, the 3rd hole, and the 4th hole. I can just use the same strategy as draw it out and make circles. So 2/5 in one, 2/5 in the other, 2/5 over here. So far, 4 cups. The 5th cup, the 6th cup, 7th cup, 8th cup, 9th cup, and 10th cup. And that's how I'm going to need 10 cups in order to fill 4 liters of milk by putting 2/5 in each cup. I'll need 10 cups. And that's how I solved it. Your turn now. Again, you have both options. Feel free to draw it out or do it on Maths Learning Center. I'll just share the link with you in chat. The idea is use mathematical models in order to represent thoughts that are going on in your brain to make sense of the problem. So whether you use it on paper or on technology, it doesn't matter. The idea is represent the problem. Yeah. So I have pasted the problem and I'm going to keep, I think, a 2-minute timer. And let's see. One minute, 30 seconds left. I'm so sorry. I completely forgot that I had to share my screen again so you could see the problem. Yo, 2 kgs of flour in 2/3 kg cups. 3 kgs of flour in 3/4 kg cups. How many cups will you need? You have about a minute more to go. Even if you solve one problem, solve it with full thought rather than rushing into 2 problems. The number of problems don't matter, but the quality of your thinking does matter. All right. 30 more seconds. You don't need to hurry up. You don't need to speed up. Take your time. The goal is for you to solve the problem sensibly. Speed is not a goal. Class?
Yes.
Class?
Yes.
Yes.
Class, class, class.
I think people are missing. Yes.
Class.
I really love how you were focusing on the pattern and you responded back with that pattern. Amazing. For those of you who solved this problem on a piece of paper, let me show you how the solution would look like. It would look like two holes, two thirds in each cup, and that's how three cups are needed. Or else, and for the second problem, 3 kgs flour. So I'll have three holes partitioned into fourths, three fourths in each cup, and you would need 4 cups. And this is how you would solve it. If you solve this problem on Maths Learning Center, please share with us your responses so others can see how you were able to solve it. Anyone who solved the problem using Math Learning Center? All right, I have.
Yes, ma'am.
Shravanti is consistently using Math Learning Center, which is amazing. I can also see, all right, we have, just going to show you, oh, fantastic. Such a visual, you know, hold on, Vidya, I just need to spotlight your work. Just give me a second. Yeah, please.
So we have string also. She was continuously in different work. She was showing her work. So
absolutely. Yeah. What I really love is the models are allowing you to communicate ideas with clear sense, right? Oh, I can see there's one more person who's showing their work. I think Muskan is showing her work as well. All right. I think let's probably take a screenshot here. I would love to show it. Love to look at the strategies after. Fantastic, guys. Thank you so much for sharing your work. We can go ahead and
let's that's a great idea, Rudri. We could even share this screenshot in the Telegram.
Exactly. Yeah, we can share. And Shalini, if possible, I know there are many links on chat. And I don't know if later we are going to have chat history saved. But if you can save the chat history, please do. That way we can show it to everyone.
Yeah, definitely.
Again, I think I'm in awe of Shravanti's work. It's just fantastic how clearly she has represented the holes. I can also see that both holes are of the same size, which is amazing. Because when you're dividing, guys, in terms of fractions, each hole has to be the same. One suggestion for Shravanti, just keep this, you know, tag on. That way we can check the number of holes and what the fraction is like. But this looks fantastic. I also appreciate that, you know, you took last feedback that I shared with you about unit, 3 cups. You mentioned that over here. Amazing. Let's head back to the problem that we were at. Guys, with this, we're moving to our last lesson. Is this going ahead? It's the same problem again. So sorry, guys. The same sort of problem again. Just give me a second. I hope it loads. Yeah, Chitra also is sharing her work with us. Sorry, guys, just give me a minute. I think the presentation is taking a bit of time to load. Absolutely appreciate everyone's patience. Uh, my kids in the class would be super excited during this time and would jump saying, Miss, can I share screen? Super excited with all the power and privilege they get. All right, lesson four done. The last lesson that we are going to do right now is about fractions. Yeah, we just did this problem, right? Moong dal. Is this the problem we did?
Yes, this one.
Yeah.
We just did this, yeah. Yes, all right. I think we also did this part.
Yes.
Yes, yes.
We did it. Slides ahead. Yeah, I know you modeled it on. All right, guys, time for us to assess and check how much progress you made after the instruction happened. So for this, we are going to assess you on the same goal. Time to do a post-assessment, that mic drop moment, just to see how the progress we've made. Again, for this, you're going to need a piece of paper. You'll have 1 minute. Please stay on mute while you solve this problem and start. Now, this time you have option to do this problem on Maths Learning Center. I'm going to share the link with you for this problem in chat. You could do it online. You could do it on paper. However you prefer, you could do it. And here is the question on my screen. I have 4 kgs of sugar. I need to divide them into 2/3 kgs bag. How many bags will I fill? Show how you know and explain your thinking. Your 1 minute has started. Please solve this problem. Class.
Yes, yes.
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 Class, class, class.
Yes, yes, yes.
Yes, yes. Yes.
Classity class.
Yes.
Yes, yes.
Yes, yes. Yes.
Fantastic.
And ma'am.
What I want you to do at this point in time is think when you started the session. Think about first whether you are able to solve it. If you are able to solve it, what strategy did you use then? Versus now when the instruction has happened, whether you have been able to solve it, the strategy that you have used this time. All right, I'm just going to spotlight a couple of responses. Yes, this is fantastic. Let me take a screenshot of your work. All right. Anyone else, if you want to hold your work up or share links in chat, I would really see.
Link shared, ma'am.
I can see Shravanti has yet again shared the link with us in chat. And is this the previous link? I think this is the previous link that I've opened. Okay, I can see Chitra's link this time. Can she see Shravanti's link as well? Oh, yes. Yeah. 6 bags. Fantastic.
There is one sharing. Sharing Yongzoom is also sharing.
Yes. I took the screenshot of the
It's really
It's on spotlight as well for everyone to see. Guys, I want to just open it up to everyone. Please share with me, like, when you solved this problem for pre-assessment, what strategy did you use? How did you solve the problem then? I'm sure, like, we're all, like, you know.
Varsha has shared something on the chat. Just have a look.
Yeah, earlier it was difficult. I started with dividing fractions, but not. I made use of rectangle model, and now it's very easy. Yes, feel free to unmute yourself, guys. Shalini has absolutely, Shubhangi. Earlier, when you must have used it, you used a procedure of flipping numbers and getting your answer 6. If yes. You did that, you don't have to feel terrible. Because now I know that here on, if you ever encounter a fraction problem, you will not flip numbers, you will not use a procedure, you will actually use a strategy that you are able to talk about to solve the problem. And that is what I want to highlight over here. So I'm sure many of you would have solved it pehle and got 6 bags as your answer. But was it conceptual? Were you able to explain how did you get the 6? Pehle, were you able to tell me why did you flip the number? If as educators, anyone over here, if you can explain me why do we flip the numbers, then we should all use that strategy. But if you cannot explain me why did you flip the number to solve a problem, then my suggestion is don't use a strategy like that. Don't use a procedure as a teacher when you can't explain that to your kid. Only use stuff that you are able to make sense of, are able to explain it to your children, and your children can explain it back to you. Want to ask you, after the instruction, now when you solved it, whatever you did on the piece of paper, can you use your words and explain me what you did? Anyone, how did you solve this problem this time? Can you use your words and explain it to me? Anyone, guys, just unmute.
I did it on Math Learning Center using rectangle model. So fantastic. That makes the concept easier because child friendly and pictorial based, and students can understand rather than just telling them reciprocal and multiply and then do that instead of doing that.
Absolutely. So when you solve that problem, did you first make 4 holes? Then did you circle 2/3, 2/3, 2/3, 2/3, 2/3, and that's how you got 6?
Yes.
Yeah, and that's how you got 6 bags. See, you were able to explain the strategy. You were exactly able to communicate the how, the thoughts that went in your brain. When we teach procedures, often kids don't know why are we doing what we're doing. And when that happens, now, learning does not stay in your brain for a long time. Then kids start thinking that, listen, this class is useless. I don't know why am I doing, why am I in this class? I'm just supposed to sit and learn. But this is only situations where they don't know the why. And I feel like as educators, I feel, you know, our experiences as kids has also been like that. The reason you are, sometimes we also end up doing that or teaching that is because that is what we learned. But as educators, it's time for us to switch and make the change for our kids, because our kids are the future. If they are not able to critically think about the why, the how and the what, we're not going to be able to make a long-term impact. Yeah. Going back to the presentation, I hope this time there are no glitch. And this is just a challenge problem. If you feel very enthusiastic, you must solve it after. The question is 3 whole 3/4 kgs, kgs or liters of milk. And you got to put that in 3/4 kgs bags. I'm just going to skip this slide because if you want to solve it, I'm going to let the problem be for you. So you are able to solve it later. And I know many of you shared the solution and this is how it looked. Just showing that problem to you in a goal plan do check strategy format. The goal was to find out how many bags will I fill. In order to solve this problem, you draw models, you partition holes into thirds, then make groups of 2/3, and you will be able to make 6 groups. So you would use 6 bags. And this is a solution for that. All right. Just want everyone to leave with a couple of more ideas. I'm sure you experienced a couple of ahas, if not many. But I also want to share with you the work, the ideas I was trying to share with you are also ideas that are very well grounded in research. So I want to share with you what our experts in the field trying to tell us. Okay. So one of the studies that happened in 1908 is a very old study, and this was conducted by Jude. And what they were trying to understand is how, what is the difference in learning when you're learning a procedure versus when you learn something with understanding, okay? And for this, they had two study groups, okay? And they were all assessed on throwing darts, basically. So what happened was, this group, first group that was learning a procedure sort of a situation, they had to throw darts at a target which was underwater. Okay? So they kept practicing, they kept practicing, they kept practicing. Okay. Then there was this other group. What this group did was they got a different side, different way of instruction. What they learned about was how when you're trying to aim at a dart underwater, because of refraction of light, your target is very deceptive. So they learned about the why, okay? And what happened is, of course, in practice rounds, both the groups killed it. Both of them did fantastic. It's similar to, you know, how when you're teaching procedure in class, your kids who have procedural understanding, of course, they do well, but your other kids who learn with understanding, of course, on practice task, even they'll do well. Then what happened was, when they wanted to assess the outcomes, what they did was they adjusted the target, and now the target underwater was 4 feet. Yeah, 4 feet, 4 inches, something like that. And that's where they found a difference. The group that learned the procedure was not able to transfer their learning. But the group that learned about refraction of light and how target can be deceptive, they were able to adjust their practices and were still able to aim at the target, which was 4 inches, 4 feet underwater. That is power of teaching with understanding. When you use models in class, they allow you to teach concepts with understanding. You did not use any procedure today. You just followed a visual to make sense, and that's how you solved it.
Yes.
If this research was not enough, I have one more research to share with you. This research was conducted by Janpu Park and Elizabeth Brannan. This is a very recent research. And what they tried to do was, they tried to understand what parts of the brain lit up when you're trying to solve a maths problem. Yeah. What they found out was that when you try to solve a maths problem with numbers, which are abstract, different parts of your brain are in working. Whereas when you're trying to solve the problem visually, different areas, like they're not the same areas. Agar draw it out karte ho, to different area action mein hota hai. When you're using abstract numbers, altogether different areas. So what they found out was that when there's more brain activity, there are better results when you combine visual with abstract. When you use both, that's when there is more brain activity. And that is good for our learners. You know, in addition to that, what they also did was, they tried to see what was achievement after kids had learned only abstract, only visual, and with abstract and visual. They tried to see how are these learners making progress. And you know what they found out? Kids who tried to, who were taught visually had outperformed kids who, who only learned using abstract numbers. So kids who did visual maths, they outperformed. Their achievement scores were much higher than kids who only did like abstract numbers. So only did things like, 25 plus 35 with numbers. But kids who did it visually with models, with visuals, they scored much higher and with a very big margin. Yeah. So you can almost leave your abstract strategy and only work on visual problems. Now, if this wasn't enough, there's one more person that I want to talk to you about. Over here on my screen, who you are seeing, guys, is Maryam Mirza Khani. She honestly is, I think, the best mathematicians of our time. She passed away in 2018 because of cancer. But from what I have read about her stories, she does, and again over here also on the picture, you know, you will see that on the floor she has like huge, very big papers where she's trying to solve problems, and she only solves problems visually. It's just so visual that her three-year-old daughter actually thought that, you know, her mother is an artist and she's not a mathematician. So often we think, you know, when mathematicians are working on things, they are working on far, very fancy abstract stuff. But guys, that's not true. Mathematicians visualize every single big idea and they try and solve every problem visually, and that's how they do it. She's also won, the Fields Medal, which is like the Nobel Prize in the field of mathematics. So like, that's how her great her work is. Please do check out about her work. And, you know, she often talked about how math doesn't have to be abstract and it can be so visual and so much more fun. Big ideas that I want to leave you with is, mathematical models allow you to visualize concepts, abstract concepts, and help you as a teacher to teach any idea with understanding, and hence bring them to your class. Don't hesitate to bring these models to your class. In today's session, the key strategy you learn for problem solving is the use of models. It could be low tech, it could be high tech, so please use them. I know it's 4:28, but I'm going to take like 5 more minutes try and quickly wrap up, but I don't want it to be very rushed. So we'll try and make it as crisp as I can. So what I'm about to show you guys is a journey from kindergarten, and you can just extend it till whatever grade that you can, okay? So when kids start school, they're in junior, KG, kindergarten, or nursery, they start looking at items and they learn how to count, okay? So they look at an item, they see 1, they see 2, they see 3, 4, 5, 6, and they master this in their early years, okay? From there, what happens is, as they move to grade 1, they start looking at items that are together and they start adding them. So they're exposed to 3 and 3 that make 6. From there, in a couple of months, they also learn about how 6 take away 3 is the same as 3. They learn about subtraction. From there, in the next grade, they also learn about fractions. After they've learned fractions, they also learn about multiplication. They learn that 3 times 2 is 6. And also that 6 divided by 3 is the same as 2. So there are 2 in each group. From there, they also learn about how you can divide a whole into 4 equal parts and you would have 1/4. As they go further in grade 6, they also learn about percentages and how 25% becomes a benchmark value for us to understand. What I want to tell you is, look at the model. Did my model change? It did not. It was one pothole model that starts at kindergarten and can go on to as many, you know, complex ideas in mathematics. What these models allow you to do is visualize ideas, make connections, learn about concepts and connections. As educators, they allow you to teach something with understanding, support with efficiency, like transfer of learning, and much more. And for this reason, you should be using models in your classes. And this is not something I'm sharing in, you know, keeping in mind like special ed context or anything. This is just general best practice in mathematics for everyone. It's universally designed. As educators, you play a very big role in how your students use maths and also learn maths. So if you know the why and the how, you are more likely to teach your kids about the why and the how. Your strategies will change if you know more. So it's absolutely okay for you to not know things, but spend some time, think about why. See how you can visualize that idea and try to use that and change the way, their learning happens. Don't teach them what you learned. I mean, unless if it's conceptual, of course, teach it. But if it's a procedure, question, find out the why and then teach it. Just ending with a last question for everyone. We use pothole models in class because of which reason? I want you to respond in chat. What do you think? Is it because representing abstract numbers visually builds conceptual understanding? Or is it because it's fun to draw shapes and doodle in maths class? Or do you think that drawing a model helps students to see the connections and other maths concepts? Or do you think it's option D, both A and C? Why? Why should we be drawing pothole models in our class? Why should we? Yes. Amazing. Yeah, guys, I agree. It is option D. It can be option B, yeah, guys. It can be actually. Like, kids can invariably learn that it's fun to draw things and draw shapes in maths class. It's not the purpose for you as a teacher. So if they think of that, tell them that we also like the doodles and the drawings, but we love the models. And for this reason, we love them because they allow us to see connections and visualize abstract ideas. With this, we're done. Couple of universal design or best practices strategies that we used in the session are related to check your learning. The moment you do something like a pre and post, you make students aware about the progress they've made. They start appreciating the instruction and see how their effort has contributed to success. So we did that. You also saw me use gradual release of responsibility model, which is I do, we do, you do it together, and then you do it alone. Every time we solve a math problem, we always had a context. So remember, context plays a very big role in mathematics. You also saw goal, plan, do, check strategy. We looked at some models. Your power, we also used attention grabbers. They just allow students to, make them stop with whatever they are doing, bring the attention. That way, as an educator, when you've given an instruction, you've just said it once and everyone's heard you, rather than you calling one instruction like 30 times or like 5 times also. Just saves more time. I'm sharing a couple of resources. I'm just linking them here on this slide. Feel free to access these resources. I'm going to share the presentation with you as well. I have a, you can scan this QR code and get access to the presentation if you like. And I'll also be sharing the presentation with the team, so they'll be able to.
Yeah, and we'll be sharing this presentation in the Telegram group. I think we will, you all are there on that group. If not, then we will share a link with you right now. So Shalini, please also share the feedback form link. And once you fill up this feedback form, you will receive the certificate in your mail. Okay. And I just want to thank Rudri, for such an engaging session. You were really very active throughout and made us actively engage with our understanding, with both low-tech as well as high-tech ways, and giving us so many choices in expressions and making us think harder about what really helps students in learning fractions. Shalini, you want to say some words?
Thank you, Ruchi. Just want to, I know Shalini is going to unmute and share. Guys, meanwhile, I've just shared a Mentimeter feedback form. It'll be fantastic. I know you're going to fill the other form as well, but that'll be for a certificate. The form that I have shared with you is like literally 1 minute form. Of course, it won't give you the other form that I shared will not give you for your, you know, certificate, but I would love to get feedback from you. That way I'm able to improvise on my practices as a facilitator. So please share with me your inputs so I can plan my other sessions differently and know what works and what doesn't work.
Ma'am, when I open, it's blank, ma'am. I open the Mentimeter, there are no questions. No active question for this presentation.
Yeah, there is no active questions.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I'm going to check.
I think just figure it out, Rudri. Meanwhile, you can fill the other form, please.
Absolutely, yes, yeah. Guys. Please fill the other form meanwhile.
Yeah.
Can you please
can you show the QR code, ma'am? I can scan it.
Excuse me?
I think let her figure it out. Let her fix it. And then she will share the QR code. Meanwhile, you can fill the other form. She'll share that. Yeah. In just 1 minute, we are going to share. Yeah. Can you see the feedback form link on the chat? Rudri, let me know when you have figured it out. It's nice when people want to get feedback and they want to know your ideas. And it is always a good idea to include the feedback in one session. So I appreciate that, Rudri. It's just that we have a regular feedback form almost always at the end of the session. It is just that. So we would really appreciate if you take up time to fill both the forms. Please do let us know any ideas that you want to be taken up in the coming sessions. Please also think about how you can use the ideas that Rudri has shared in this session, how you can build on it. Maybe next week we can discuss how to use this Math Learning Center in other ways, if you can find out some new idea, or you can try it out, this Math Learning Center with your students this week, and you can share your ideas. Maybe you can teach them fractions, maybe you can teach them something else. Let's see what are the other ways in which we can think about it. And we would really appreciate if you join next week also and share your ideas. See, it is, we teachers have always been listening to other people, but we are also our authors. We also are designers, and we design and implement in our own classrooms. Now, it is important for us to also share what results have been in our own classrooms with a larger community of educators, because that will help us to develop a deeper knowledge of teaching and learning. So I really request and urge everyone to share their ideas next week, either design or implementation. Rudri, have you figured it out? Do you want to share it again?
Yes, I have just shared it in chat with everyone. Guys, please do share feedback. Also, please post pictures of your work on the Telegram group. That way, people who weren't part of the session, they can also see what you did and are hopefully able to take some ideas back. And also, I would love to see. Also, if you can turn on your video, maybe we can click one picture or something. All right, friends, if you can, please turn on your video in the count of five. I'll take a screenshot after. Taking a screenshot in four, so turn on your camera. Taking a screenshot in three, please turn on your camera. Taking a screenshot in two, turn on your camera so we can get as many people as we can. And here, I'm taking a screenshot. I have one screenshot. Let me move to the other screen. And I didn't realize there's a third screen also. In three, to one last page. Let's get this. Thank you guys for being such a lovely audience. If you have questions, feel free to stay on or email your questions to me and I'll be happy to answer them. Otherwise, I'll see you next week with, you know, all the test and trial that you've done.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi, Miss. I just wanted to ask with reference to the presentation that you had made. Did you make use of the Microsoft Office or what were the presentations made in?
I just made it on Google Slides because it's free.
So and what about the animations, as in the character, cartoon characters that you had embedded on the slides?
They were all just, you know, taken from Google and then I just added the animation.
As in animation, as in, can you just share the resource of it?
So,
as in, most of the times what happens is when we are making any slides, most of the times these slides, they turn out to be more numerical. So students, you know, somehow they feel they are overloaded with too much information in one instance. So if you have such kinds of colorful images being embedded on the presentation, it somehow releases their burden, thinking that, you know, it's too much.
Absolutely. So I'll just show you one very quick way. I just added text box, then I had my own images. And if I click on the item and then animate, it adds the animation for me. So that's how I did it.
Okay.
Yeah, on the transitions, you can add as many animations as you like. Like I had like some good 25-30 at least for this slide. But it depends. Okay. You can chunk information differently. And and feel free to YouTube. YouTube is like one of my best friends. So if I don't know something, I'll just like go on YouTube and search it.
Okay. Okay. And ma'am, do you have any resources for the higher education, as in with reference to the 11th and 12th, or is it just with the lower levels of learning that you deal with?
So I do have experience, as in like at my school, I do teach higher grades. The strategies, honestly, that I shared, models, both low-tech and high-tech, are strategies you can generalize even at college level. Because models is the big idea. So whether you draw it out on paper or use any other tech tool, like if you go on Wolfram Mathematica, you'll find tons of graphing materials. If you go on GeoGebra, FED, yes, you're going to find tons and tons of simulations to represent maths visually.
Mm-hmm. One more thing I wanted to ask, Miss. You had us saying this, though, whenever you had that Q word going on your work, class, and then we used to say yes, and then repetition and the rhythm of it were followed. But my experience with the student has been that as we go on to teach higher levels of classes, the participation decreases of the students. Yes. The part, there is minimal participation seen in the higher classes. If we do this, then it becomes it is so heartbreaking to see that, you know, students are not participating.
Yeah, they don't participate. I agree with
participate.
You. They in fact feel that you know, we are not young kids. We don't want to participate. They are in that age where they want to show their expression and they don't want to really oblige the teacher, I would say. But so I think it is important for the teacher and student to build the relationship before one even gets to doing these kinds of activities. And I think we as adults, we understand, we empathize, we are able to participate with her even when we are meeting for the first time. But students sometimes find it difficult. But what is your response, Rudri?
I think if my students are not honestly participating in class, I would have a candid conversation and ask them, guys, you know what, one thing, one expectation I have from you is participate. but currently it seems that you're not participating. I want to know the reason behind it. And I am okay to hear anything they share with me. Even if they tell me, Miss, you know, what you did was extremely boring and I didn't want to do it. Or like from that range of response to them saying, you know, but Miss, I'd like to do something more engaging, you know, where I can talk and actually hear their feedback. I've realized that often when they say things, it allows me to then integrate their ideas and make them accountable and tell them that, hey, you agreed, you requested for this. I designed a lesson with that. So I need you to do it now, participate. So then there's like a little less back and forth in that sense. But if you treat them like young adults, include a lot of group work, student agency, you know, student choice, give them freedom to talk. And of course, I don't mean like when you give freedom to talk, as in they are talking and you are doing nothing. Feel like everything requires a structure. So like understand when to release and when to bring it back with your kids. And I think honestly, have a candid conversation. Like once they know where you're coming from and once they know that your intentions are good, you want them to actually learn and make progress and you really care about them, the more likely they are to be receptive to what you're saying. So that relationship building, giving them the freedom to tell you whatever they are feeling can honestly help you. You know, it's like how you have your relationship with your parents. You will have that love-hate relationship, right? There are days you will fight, but there are days you'll also have fantastic days. And they are possible because you communicate with them. So keep that communication channel open. They're saying they're getting bored. Theek hai, chala, I'll take the feedback. I'll probably try and improvise. Because I can't expect young children I would hate if they are not participating in class, honestly. It would bother me big time. And I would desperately do anything to get their participation. Even if it means just doing like a couple of classes of quiz, Kahoot, or we've even done things like when we were in face-to-face setup, we even would do things like maths around the room. So there would be different stations and like, you know, I would literally put like three different books, three different exercises for them to do. It literally meant that first you go to this section, then that section of the room, then that section of the room and do the work. But it just built in the movement because they had to jump from here to there. But uska matlab ye nahi tha that, you know, you don't do your work. They very much still had to produce the work. But of course, they had the freedom whether they want to go to station 1, 2, or 3. The goal was you have to do all three. How you do it is your problem. You can move around. You can collaborate with a friend. Go in the corner you want to sit. Be in class. So, but again, this came from things they shared with me. They were like, Miss, our class is in afternoon. We feel like very sleepy. So we need you to wake us up. So one thing we did was we just let them move around in the room.
Okay. One more thing that as... what is your take on a math as a subject as we grow it, as we go from lower classes to the higher classes? What is your take on that?
I think maths is a beautiful subject, full of connections. But that is not something I had known 6-7 years back, sharing it like very honestly. I think as I started teaching my kids, my maths coach at Gateway questioned me, as a new person, like, you know, but why are you doing it? But why are you doing what you're doing? So she pushed me to think a lot about the strategies and the instruction. And that sort of changed the way I looked at many ideas in maths. Like I only didn't know what was the why behind. Like, I remember the first day when I also did fractions, I may have flipped the number. But when I started questioning the why, the how can you do this visually, I came to the realization that maths is actually a subject where you're not doing random things. You're doing things because something makes sense. There's lots of pattern. There are lots of connection. There are like lots of connected ideas. But the way you and I have learned maths in school is like, you know, maths being a disconnected subject with all ideas that are not related. So you learn like addition in grade one and then you almost forget about it. That's not true. Addition, numbers are foundations to things that you are doing in higher grades. So even when you are doing algebra, you are just connecting algebra, geometry, graphs. They're all same things. They're just different representations of the concepts. And I learned all of this like over the course of 6-7 years. I'm still learning. I don't know everything to tell you.
Rudri, I'm sorry. We will have to end the session now. We have gone way beyond the time. So thanks a lot for being here. And if there are any further questions, feel free to ask us on Telegram and we can continue the discussion there. Even we can continue the discussion next week. Absolutely. So thank you everyone for being here. And we will again meet next week and continue the discussion. Absolutely. Okay then.
Ruchi and Shalini, is it possible for you guys to stay on for a minute?
Okay.
Yeah, then we can end.
Yeah.
Bye, guys. Enjoy the rest.
Bye, everyone. See ya.
Bye. Bye-bye.